Hi friends, I hope you all had a good long weekend. Welcome back to your second week of Intro to Game Design. Obviously, I'm not here with you today in your lab sections, but I wanted to make sure that we had a chance to go over just a couple of concepts before you jumped into your worksheets so that that process can go as easily as possible. The first big idea that I wanted to touch upon, and this is something we'll come back to in future lecture sessions, is the MDA framework. So this is actually one of your readings. We can kind of look over it and it provides some context around the whole idea of mechanics, dynamics, and aesthetics. But the core idea behind the MDA framework is this idea that game designers and game players approach game systems from opposite perspectives. So when we're looking at game design, designers are looking at the mechanics, kind of the rules and the systems and things like that, things that are kind of on the back end. Those mechanics and rules then create for a dynamic play experience. So that's sort of a middle layer called dynamics. And then aesthetic is the presentation of those dynamics to the player. And so really, if we think about the chain of interaction, designers are going to work primarily with mechanics, and that trickles down to dynamics and then to aesthetic. Players, on the other hand, their first encounter is with the aesthetic, with the art, with the feedback within the game, with the sound effects, things like that. That then cues them into the dynamics, what's actually happening in the game, what does the gameplay experience look like? And then from the dynamics, from the gameplay, they get some understanding of the mechanics. But in a big way, designers can't fully predict what's going to take place on the aesthetic side of things. They're not going to understand how players are perceiving stuff unless they do a lot of play testing. And players aren't going to be able to understand fully the mechanics that go into a game, unless they write up full wikis with thousands of contributors, like they've done with a lot of games. And so these just kind of represent different perspectives on design. I think it's especially important as designers, as we go in to kind of keep this in mind, that we won't always know what our player is thinking, how our player is responding to different things. And so that's where really having foundational design principles can be super helpful. One of the core ideas I wanted to introduce today is the idea of design pillars. Design pillars are essentially values that are established as part of the early design process that help to make the overall design process more coherent. So typically there will be, somewhere between one and five design pillars. More complicated games are going to have more pillars, but it is entirely possible to have a game with just one design pillar. But when we talk about design pillars, really what they are is a value or a system that pervades the entire game, that goes throughout the entire game, and it's meant to be sort of a design constraint. That will guide decision making throughout the design process. So, for example, we might bring up The Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild. I'll go ahead and mute here. But we can see even from the trailer a few of our design pillars starting to emerge. So we have this sense of exploration and immensity, right? It's the whole premise behind open world games. I think we have some really interesting mechanics having to do with traversal. So we have new ways of moving through space, whether that's running or climbing or hang gliding or riding horses. That becomes one of the design pillars. I think we have, kind of going along with that previous idea of immensity, we have exploration of arcane or magical concepts. We have a design pillar of scavenging as sort of a facet of that. So we've got all sorts of old tools that are left around this sort of abandoned, ancient world, and we're using those tools to our advantage. And so each of these things starts to become a design pillar that shapes the decisions of the game. I would say another design pillar would be something along the lines of interactivity or I don't know, like combinatorial inputs. So being able to use different abilities in combination with each other to achieve really different things. That's something that the creators actually talked about at GDC, basically saying that they based the whole system off of the idea of chemical elements. The idea that if you took one element and mixed it with another element, you might end up with a chain reaction that made for a much more interesting experience. We could go into a different game, like Team Fight Tactics. That's sort of the auto chess version of League of Legends. And Riot Games actually published an entire thing about design pillars and about the pillars that they chose in designing Team Fight Tactics. We will find that design pillars are much more common in AAA games than in indie games. But even if you're going at it alone, trying to make a game, either you or a small team, having a rough idea of those values and those ideas that you want to reinforce through your gameplay can be super helpful. In Team Fight Tactics, they identified three major ones. So the first of which is mastery. So that kind of goes along with that idea of chess, the idea that we're learning strategies, we're better understanding the different moves that each sort of character can make. We're building kind of an understanding of the meta game. Meta, we might not know this, but meta is actually an acronym that stands for most effective tactic available. And that might have come afterwards. I think it was originally its own word, and then they sort of filled in the acronym afterwards. But understanding how the game works, how the characters work, how the meta game works, those are all parts of mastery. We go down to playful competition. So it's this idea that it's a competitive game, but it's not so intense that we get mad at each other or flame each other in the comments or anything like that. You are paired with random people. You are represented by these little, they call them, I think, tiny heroes or something along those lines, but they're these cute, bright, cuddly looking creatures. It's little whales and foxes and dragons and things like that that are kind of cute and make little cute fun noises. And so that decision goes towards that idea of not just playing competition, but of playful competition, of sort of low stakes, easy, pro-social interactions, even though it's in a competitive environment. And then the last one is the idea of discovery and the future of TFT. So just like with League of Legends, TFT has a rotating cast of characters, and they have new characters that get introduced. And so that plays towards this idea of discovery. I mean, even if you've played League of Legends your whole life, the characters within Team Fight Tactics are going to behave differently. And so there's always some new way of interacting with the sort of with the lore space, with the characters, with the gameplay. And so that lends to that overall pillar of discovery. So we're just going to be in our in our workshop sessions, going through and looking at some different design pillars for some of our favorite games. Again, these are overarching ideas or mechanics that drive decision making within the design process. And so anything that violates those core design pillars is something that, we can sort of rule out. If you really think about it, the pillars become the foundations for the gameplay. And so it's not that you couldn't add other pillars, it's that you would be building a different game if you had other pillars. And so really we're looking at what are the fundamental building blocks of the game? What are the large scale ideas that shape the design decisions around the game? Sometimes that will look like mechanics. So it might be stealth mechanics and assassination mechanics and traversal, like it is in the Assassin's Creed games. It could also be larger ideas like exploration or like unlimited possibility, or, you know, things like that that you find in more open world games. But anyway, that's all for today. I'm really excited to dive back into lecture with you this coming Monday. Be sure to check out the readings for next week. And if you're having any issues, you know, turning in worksheets or anything like that, please feel free to reach out to your TAs for your lab section. And if there's, you know, if there's any problems from there, feel free to reach out to me personally. I will look forward to seeing you all on Monday, and best of luck with your workshops. Thanks.